you believe me the first time I came in and started recruiting?
Nope. It was like a dream. It really was.
I don't know. I go in and say, Upstream is summer school. And you learn how to backpack and rock climb and canoe down whitewater rivers. And people laugh at me.
I'll honestly say I thought it was the day camp type program. I did not have any idea that it was going to be what it turned out to be.
Operation Upstream is a no-nonsense outdoor living school. We teach rock climbing, backpacking, whitewater canoeing. It's for Atlanta high school boys and girls. We hold it each summer up in the North Georgia mountains. One of the most important things that we teach up there is outdoor survival, how to live off the land.
I want you to remember that. All water in this area runs into the Chattahoochee River. And David has gone over you all the edibles and everything that you could live forever in these mountains. Tree snails, crawdads, salamanders, trout, all the edibles. Right here you can see enough edibles to live forever. You can eat hemlock bark and live the rest of your life. Find a big hemlock tree and sit down beside it. There's no way to starve in these mountains. You could come out weighing more than you ever went in. There's enough crawdads in there to feed an army almost. There's enough tree snails. There's like eating oysters. David told you to cut the antennas off in there.
Why would you cut the antennas off?
So if you don't cut antennas off, when you eat them, you'll pick up WSB or something. Especially if you got braces or something. But you got enough tree snails there forever and ever. So anytime you get lost, there's abundance of food, tremendous amount of food, and David has already pointed out to you, you've seen it, to live forever, follow running water, there's no way to ever get lost. Never. Okay, now, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about backpacking. Then I'm going to go over the three-day trip with you. In the first place, tomorrow, anytime you're backing or you're through the mountains or anywhere else, and you're leading a group, you know, we're talking about group survival. We're not talking about individual survival because we are a group. If you should ever come to a split trail, and you're undecided which way to go as of tomorrow. The map's hazy or somebody's come and knocked a new trail in or something like that. Does anybody know the procedure when you come to a split trail?
You want to look the oldest.
Did anybody tell you? Well, I'm going to tell you because tomorrow if you come to a split trail, and incidentally, tomorrow, I know y'all have elected three leaders, but the staff, we always pick a leader out of the kids for this. Not one of your chosen leaders, but another one to lead. And the staff picked Jack Murray as the overall leader on this.
High fire.
Yeah.
Boy, I just think when we get ready to go up to Blood Mound, boy, it's going to be trouble. Ooh.
Hope it doesn't rain.
In the hills. Yeah, there's a chance. Hell of high. You better take your poncho.
I did. I put mine right on top of my pack.
I'll ash mine on the bottom.
Yeah, we get to it quick.
When we get up there, we better try to find some wood and hide some, because once you get wet, you'll never get a fire
started. I got the shelter plan.
Yeah, I hope I can get the cabin.
There's not enough room for everybody in that shelter up on top of the mountain.
It's hard to first in there.
Rats will eat you up.
Right. I got the deer is holding away from the rats.
There's a cave under the rocks down there.
I was never to get wet in that.
Sleep too good.
Waking up in the morning on Operation Upstream is about the hardest thing you could possibly do. Because you had to get up, put on your boots, and get the muster always within inside of 1 minute. In fact, I remember the guys that were sleeping next to me. They couldn't put on their boots in time. So they'd wake up every morning, 4 in the morning, put on their boots, lace them up, and go back to sleep. So they'd be ready for 6 o'clock in the morning. You up in the morning, it was calisthenics. You better believe it. From 60 seconds, from lying in your nice warm blankets, 60 seconds later, you would be doing push-ups, sit-ups, side straddle hop, and all types of various sundry things.
Climbing a rope, carrying that pack, too. All the way up and around. Stretch it out.
3-day hike is important because it's the first time these students are really turned out on their own. After several weeks of intense instruction in a variety of skills in first aid and rescue, how to use a map and compass, how to live in the woods comfortably and undestructively, we turn them loose for 3 days to walk under their own supervision from base camp to Blood Mountain, one of the highest mountains in the state. And consistently, it's an educational experience to watch these people rise to the occasion.
When you go out on the 3-day hike, you realize for the first time that you're totally on your own. You don't have any instructors or staff watching over you. It's up to you to get there safely and get there back. And fortunately, group pressure keeps everybody together. Without it, there would be arguments and dissenters among the group and things such as that. So, but when you have this group pressure and this unity that everybody has, Blood Mountain hike is most enjoyable. My first few days with Upstream was something like I have never experienced before. I had never done very much camping in my life previous to Upstream. I was thrown into a totally different environment, something I'd never been experienced before in my life.
Well, that's called culture shock. For all practical purposes, you step from the 20th century back to the Stone Age.
It's hard for me to put into words, but it was something that just changed my life innumerably.
You know, well, you lived a month out of a backpack. Your house for that month was a 10 by 10 sheet of plastic. Did you ever think that could be comfortable?
That would have, in my earlier days, that would have sounded like torture to me. It really would have.
But it works, doesn't it?
It works.
And it's one thing that I've noticed that happens very often is when you come back, you've got to readjust.
That's very true.
Did you have that problem?
The first few days, the sight of cars and all the sound and the noise of the city was totally offensive to me. And the air was...
Could you tell a difference in the air when you came back?
I could definitely tell a difference in the air. Yeah. There's no question about it. The pollution, the stagnation that you get in the city.
And how about the refrigerator? Did you appreciate that?
Appreciated the refrigerator. Anything cold, I appreciated. But I can honestly say, when I was back for 2 days, I wanted to be back up there.
Pretty unique water program that's developed there. I really don't think you can find another one quite like it in the country. We cover small craft and life saving and the survival stuff. What do you remember of that?
Well, I particularly remember the survival swimming part because this is the first time I've ever seen a program where you're taught how to swim in a group and survive in a group, even if you have people who can't swim with you. And the life-saving and the first aid all fits into this.
A lot of those kids have come back after the Upstream thing and commented they've actually had to use that rescue technique.
Oh, I'm
pull
sure.
out a member of the family.
Yeah, I'm sure it happens a lot. Because since Upstream, I've become a lifeguard and got my WSI. Probably as a result of Upstream. And I see it happening all the time.
The small craft training, do you remember that?
Definitely.
Getting ready for the Chattooga. What a hilarious joke it was to get out on that flat lake and practice, but it paid off in the end.
It did pay off, but I remember when they all first climbed into their rafts, they couldn't row, they couldn't paddle, they couldn't go in a straight line.
Couldn't go in a straight line. It looked like
life.
A Chinese fire drill line.
Yeah, it sure did. But they sure did improve quick. And by the end of the Chattooga, you're ready. Rah!
Turn left! And all right, straight line! Head for the shore!
Hey, who's not doing it?
Swim your raft in this way.
Swim it in
this way.
Come on.
Put your hands on the rope.
When I first saw the mountain, my first expression was, are we going to climb that?
Oh, hey, it isn't that bad. You got used to it, didn't you?
Well, out of all the things in Upstream, I would say that puts you more in a stress situation than anything else we did.
The mountain is pretty representative. On Upstream, we say everything can be reduced to the rock. You've got, first of all, everything is so clear cut. You and your life is completely dependent on the other person, the belayer at the top of the rock.
Okay.
And the way he handles his rope. People learn a lot about themselves, and they learn a lot about other people.
That's definitely true. In fact, I remember the first climb I did, I was so scared that I didn't know where I was. And if I were to fall in, my life depended on the belayer at the top. I was totally dependent on him.
Yeah, but, you know, as scary as it was for you, think about, you did belaying too, eh?
Yeah. And so somebody else's life was then dependent upon me.
Right, that's a good time to start growing up.
That's right. This way you learn your stress limit at the same time that everybody else is learning theirs, and therefore you build unity with one another because you're experiencing the same thing, and you're growing together.
Norman, Buddha made now your first step's tough, isn't it?
He's telling me.
First step,
I'll tell you, I can get over
to you.
Wait
up.
No, that's okay.
Your neck is passing bolt right up here to your left. You see it?
You may have to move over. I'll let him start right here. Yeah. There you go.
First is coming back.
Look way up high left. Oh.
You people that aren't climbing, watch these people
falling
and learn from their mistakes.
Falling. A little bit late.
It's hard and it's scary, but, you know, one of the most beautiful sights, I think, in the whole that I have ever seen is from the top up there, looking down on the top of the buzzards.
On top of the buzzards. I'll have to agree with you, because I remember the satisfaction I felt when I got to the top. You just sat down and looked, and you could just see for miles and miles. It's just beautiful. And you really felt proud that you had accomplished something.
Lane one slack.
Good.
Lane 5, 33.
Lane 2. Belay 4 feet turn.
Lane 2 off belay.
Very good. Very good.
Bob, will they set the belay position?
You kind of got to feel at home up there, didn't you, after a while? About 4 days up there.
Right, after 4 days, that's home to you. You love that rock.
Yes, you're fine where you are. That way it'll pull you straight up there. Otherwise, it'll pull you off balance to the sides. Looking good, Lane 1.
Good, Lane 2.
should open at the bottom.
It should open down here.
Look,
snap it in.
No.
And then turn it. And then
put the rope in.
Slack.
Lane one, slack.
There you go, that's right.
Lane three. Lane three. Lane five,
off
the lane.
Climb
in, blue lane.
Hold it. Lane three, where's your command?
Lane three, off the lane. 25 feet.
Better can't get through about 15 or 20.
themselves in activities like rock climbing or backpacking 20 miles a day, or actually living in the middle of a wilderness area and doing it comfortably. After they adapt to that idea, they pull it off as well, if not better, than you guys.
They perform as well. They do everything as well as we do.
They do all of the same activities, rock climbing. I'm afraid they've got y'all beat hands down if you want to get down to comparisons.
Physical anatomy, huh?
Right.
If you're going to try something you have no idea about, take a very small amount, chew it a lot, get the taste in your mouth, and it's real rancid, you won't want to even swallow it.
Awful. You'll know when you taste it. You'll know.
Then, wait 15 minutes to half an hour after you swallow it.
And if you feel sick, you'll know it was poison.
Well, Keith, okay, you're out on solo and you're feeling sick.
You run to the person next to you.
You just sit in the creek. Eat it. No. We have the day lilies, the elderberry, and the sumac.
we're going to have people gathering. We have people gathering.
Okay.
Ferns, hemlock, plantain, ginger, daisies, tree snails, fishing, crawdads, huckleberries, blackberries. I know it's some tremendous blackberries. We are going to have three blackberry cobbler pies.
All right.
Okay, so why don't you come and get these books here. Anybody who's really interested in something? And
what time is that?
7:30.
All right, 11 o'clock for our next muster. These two.
What was one thing you brought back with you from Australia? What did you learn in the program that you can apply to your daily life?
Well, when I first came back, I was proud. And I had more self-confidence in myself and belief in myself than I've ever had before. And I found that I could do unbelievable things, things I never dreamed possible before.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, then, you walked away from the program with exactly what we want to teach. The main thing is on Operation Upstream is not what you learn, but what you forget. Those two words, I can't.